We're on a trip around the world, and today we'll be making a delicious chicken curry from Guyana. I don't know why, but every time I'm following a recipe and they say to adjust the spice to your liking and it calls for two peppers, I'll still try and put two peppers even if I'm halving the recipe, because I just love spice. But if you don't like spice and you're following this recipe, feel free to adjust the spice to your liking. We're gonna marinate our chicken for 30 minutes. While you're waiting, you can peel and chop your potatoes for the curry. We'll add our curry paste to the pan, letting our flavors come alive for 2 to 3 minutes before adding our chicken. Cook for 10 to 15 minutes before adding your water, or your flavors will fall off your chicken, and we don't want that. Add our tomato paste, cinnamon stick, cloves, and potatoes, and let it cook for another 15 minutes, and allow it to thicken, because we don't want a runny curry. Really sad I didn't have any roti to pair this with, as that is a popular choice, so I just had rice. This was incredible, thank you. We're going around the world, and what's on the menu tonight, you might ask? Why, it's stufat tofenek. I was so excited to make this because I've never had rabbit before. Yes, we'll be making a rabbit stew from Malta. We start by marinating our rabbit overnight in red wine. The next day, we roll our potatoes off the table and roughly chop. And I'm not sure why, but peeling vegetables summons my dog. So once you've finished chopping your carrots, make sure you save at least one piece or he'll never forgive you. Then you wash your hands and chop your onions. Once your rabbit has soaked up all those nice wine juices, we're gonna sear them for 4 minutes on each side and then removing them from the pan. Nice and golden. We'll then add our onions, diced tomatoes, rest of our marinade, bay leaves, and our meat back in the pot, covering it with water and letting it cook for 30 minutes. Add our vegetables towards the end. This dish pairs well with mashed potatoes, but I'm not gonna tell you how to make them. I'm sure you can do it. Once your rabbit has been cooking for about an hour and it's nice and tender, you can plate it and optionally top it with a fresh sprig of rosemary. Cheers. This is the series where I make something new from each country just to challenge myself. For today's episode, I chose Ono Khao Sui, which was recommended to me by my friend April, who makes a lot of other Burmese food on their TikTok, so you should check them out too. I don't want to spoil anything, but this dish directly translates to coconut noodles. So I'm gonna need to make the noodles. Can you believe I've never made noodles by hand before? I always thought I would need that fancy pasta machine roller thing, but it turns out you just need a really nice sharp knife. So I'm really glad that Kuma sent me this incredible Japanese style knife. It made cutting these noodles a breeze. It also sliced through this chicken like a boss. Let that marinate for 30 minutes. In the meantime, we can boil our eggs. A lot of people ask me how to get the perfect soft boiled egg, and the answer is 6 minutes, and then you immediately dunk them in an ice water bath to stop them from cooking. Perfect every time. I'm getting sidetracked. For our soup base, we're gonna pour all of these ingredients in a pot and let it simmer for 10 minutes. Cook the noodles for 2 to 3 minutes, running them under cold water to stop them from cooking. And then we assemble our bowl using all the best toppings, including crispy fried noodle scraps. All that's left to do is dig in. A beautiful golden yeasted crust, torn and dipped in a center of molten cheese and egg yolk. Oh, you want to know how to make it? Let's go. First off, I want to acknowledge the dedication that this commenter had on all of my videos. I swear they told me to make this. I'm not gonna lie, I had to do it 2 times just because I thought I could do better. And it wasn't torturous at all. I mean, eating more cheesy bread, like, I'm all for it. You're gonna wanna make your dough a day in advance because we have to refrigerate it overnight. This makes quite a few portions, so if you want, you can freeze the dough. Make it again another day. The ideal cheese ratio is 1 to 1 to 1, or it might be a bit salty. Stretch that beautiful dough, and then we're gonna roll it into boats. This is the most fun part, I'm not gonna lie. And if you have a pizza stone, then you can bake it at 500 degrees for about 12 minutes. Make a little well for your yolk and brush the edges with butter. And this is really all you need. Ta-da! Now it's time to dig into. If this isn't the prettiest soup you've ever seen in your entire life, like, I think you're lying to me. And it's all because of beets. Did you really think I put like pink food coloring in my soup? No way. I decided to stop pretending to hate beets just to eat this soup, because it's just too pretty not to try. Also, Latvia, did you know that your flag matches the color of sliced beets? I don't think it's a coincidence, actually. Have you ever been like, oh, I want soup, but it's not aesthetically pleasing? This is the soup for you. Eat pink stuff. Sometimes I'll stumble upon a dish and I'll be really surprised that I haven't had it before. Like, it's straight up my alley. Has all the best ingredients, and I own all the ingredients, and yet I never had it or even knew it existed. Okay, I'm gonna be honest, I had to go buy Thai chilies. But other than that, you can just find all this stuff in your house, I swear. But I'm pretty sure bonus points if you grow your own basil, like me. I can already hear the comments being like, basil? It's basil. I don't want to hear it. I just want to eat it. And you should make it too. There's chicken, spiciness, and it has an egg? I mean, come on. Itsy Land with Around the World in Food, a series where I try to make a dish from each country just to challenge myself. But you guys already knew that. In fact, I keep receiving great suggestions of countries and dishes from you guys. Did I mention we're doing Denmark? My first mission was to find the bread. It is the key component to make a good smørrebrød. This is a Danish open-faced sandwich, quote-unquote, usually topped with cold cuts like fish and meat, as well as spreads. The best part is that you can do it however you want. There are so many different combinations and variations, but what drew me in was how stunning they look. I jumped at the chance to unleash my inner artist. I even drew a little picture of how I wanted them to look like. Just because I was making three, and I was starting to lose track of which things I wanted on what toast, it's all about the garnishes. Make sure you get some microgreens and fresh herbs to put on there. They'll really level up the appearance. And there you have it. The most breathtakingly beautiful lunch you'll probably ever have in your entire life. This is Around the World in Food, where I make something from each country just to challenge myself. This one was a long time coming. I decided to make quindim, a very popular Brazilian dessert made from egg yolks, sugar, and coconut. We're gonna wanna start by whisking our egg yolks and sugar until they're super pale and fluffy. Next, I added a squeeze of lemon, the butter, and lastly, the coconut. What's nice about this recipe is that it makes about one or two servings, one if you have a slightly deeper ramekin. Make sure you grease your mold and dust it in a nice little coating of sugar. We'll then bake them at 350 degrees and put them in a water bath. This will ensure nice, even cooking. Allow them to cool before inverting them onto a plate. I did not show myself doing that because it's always a struggle and I like to pretend like I'm a perfect human being. This is my Around the World series where I make something new from each country just to challenge myself. Today I tackled xiaolongbao, or more popularly known as a soup dumpling. How do you get the soup in there? Well, you're gonna need a whole chicken. Well, technically you don't need the chicken. You wanna save the drippings and store it in your fridge for 4 hours. You can use the chicken for something else later. Then, you guessed it, we're gonna have to make dough by hand for the wrappers. Once you combine the flour and water, you're just gonna let it rest for 20 minutes. Then you focus on your filling. Throw all of these things listed into a bowl. And you're gonna assume 4 hours have passed and take out your aspic. The most fun part is taking the fat off the top. I don't care what you say. Forbidden jello. You're just gonna crush it up with a fork and then add it into your filling. So when we steam it, it melts and you get the soup. I'm getting ahead of myself. Take your nice, smooth, rested dough and you're gonna divide it into 20 pieces, rolling them out super thin and working one at a time. I can't explain how to pleat them. I don't even know how. I think I did okay for my first time though. This is what we've all been waiting for. Steam it for 8 minutes and then you'll have your awesome homemade xiaolongbao. Cheers. It's my Around the World series where I make a new dish from each country just to challenge myself. Today is Portugal. If you haven't heard of egg tarts, you're living under a rock. If you haven't made them, understandable. I'm a little disappointed with myself for how these turned out, but you live and you learn. I should have mailed away my envelope-sized butter block when I had the chance. This tart is iconic for its flaky crust, which means we're gonna have to make a sort of croissant-like dough, which involves a lot of lamination, which essentially means folding butter into your dough very strategically. Many times, which isn't all that bad, except for the fact that you have to wait 30 minutes in between each rollout, or your butter will be too soft and you'll ruin the entire thing. After your first butter fold and rest, you want to make sure you roll out your dough lengthwise. We then fold the two ends to the middle and fold it in half, and do this 2 times. You don't have to be all that gentle with your dough. In fact, smacking it a couple times really does the trick. Once you've made it to your last rollout, we roll it up tightly into a log, and you guessed it, put it in the fridge for 30 minutes. Side note, do you like my green and blue eggs? They're very pretty, but not necessary. Oh yeah, by the way, this is the custard or filling for the tarts that you're making right now. Take out your dough log and cut them 2 centimeters thick, and you can marvel at your lamination work. I honestly think this is where I went wrong, because I don't have individual tart molds, so I don't think they cooked very evenly. But you can let me know how I did, and good luck to you if you try these out yourself. Wow, would you look at that? It's your friendly neighborhood Elan, bringing you another What I Eat in a Day. A random thing about me is that I actually have a farm, and we grow a lot of produce. Therefore, it's my mission to use it, which is why I've been eating potatoes like every day. Drop some good potato recipes below. On my way to the gym, I was really hungry, so I had nitro and a crab onigiri. And of course, this week I made smørrebrød, so I had some leftover ingredients, which is why I had it for lunch. And apparently I was really in a fish mood today, so I made some cod green curry. I actually made the green curry paste from scratch and topped it with lotus petals. Have you ever had those? They're actually so good. And when I'm not having around the world food, I'll just eat some bread. Nothing beats a chocolatey slice of bread. Another day, another country. Today I chose Switzerland. And no, this is not challah. This bread is actually called Sulz. Thought we would get that debate out of the way before I start. Although its appearance may be similar, the difference is the use of butter. As with most breads, we need some flour. Since this is a yeasted bread, we're gonna combine our warm milk and yeast along with some sugar and add it to our flour. Lastly, we add copious amounts of butter to make our dough so silky smooth that you'll just wanna spank it. And then sadly, we have to let it rise for 2 hours. As you might have seen before, this bread is woven like a braid. Legend has it that the origin comes from the practice of a widow cutting off her braid and burying it with her husband. But instead, they started using bread. And although this is just a folkloric tale, it does make for a good story. And if you aren't a widow and you just want to make some really tasty bread, the best way to achieve this is to brush your risen bread with egg wash and bake it in a convection oven at 390 degrees for 30 minutes. If it passes the hollow sound test, then your Zopf is ready.